Blackstone Audio presents The Anti-Chomsky Reader by Peter Collier and David Horowitz, editors. Introduction. Peter Collier. The dust jacket of hegemony or survival, Noam Chomsky's attack on U.S. foreign policy and the elites who supposedly control it, calls the author the world's foremost intellectual activist. Normally, such a statement could be dismissed as a publisher's hyperbole, but this claim about Chomsky exists in an echo chamber of similar sentiments. According to the Chicago Tribune, Chomsky is the most cited living author and ranks just below Plato and Sigmund Freud among the most cited authors of all time. While acknowledging that he is reviled in some quarters for his ferocious anti-Americanism and cavalier relationship with the factual record, a recent New Yorker profile calls Chomsky one of the greatest minds of the 20th century. Even this rapturous praise does not quite capture the extent of the Chomsky phenomenon. At this point in his career, Chomsky is more a cult figure, the L. Ron Hubbard of the New Left, one writer called him, than a writer or even a theorist. Most of his books are pamphlets in disguise, collections of speeches or interviews strung together, as in the case of the best-selling 9/11, which was assembled by email with the assistance of his protégés. Rock groups such as Rage Against the Machine and Pearl Jam promote Chomsky at their concerts the way the Beatles once promoted the guru Maharaji, solemnly reading excerpts from his work between sets and urging their followers to read him too. Manufacturing Consent. A documentary adapted from a Chomsky book of the same title has achieved the status of an underground classic in university film festivals. And at the climactic moment in the Academy Award-winning Good Will Hunting, the genius janitor played by Matt Damon vanquishes the incorrect thinking of a group of sophomoric college students with a fiery speech quoting Chomsky on the illicit nature of American power. The devotion of Chomsky's followers is summarized by radio producer David Barsamian, who describes the master's effulgence in openly religious terms. He is, for many of us, our rabbi, our preacher, our Rinpoche, our sensei. But unlike other cult figures, Chomsky's power is not commanded by the authority of charisma or the electricity of revelation. His speeches are flat and fatwa-like, hermetically sealed by syllogism and self-reference against the oxygen of disagreement. His power comes not from his person, but from the fact that he, more than any other contemporary public intellectual, gives an authentic voice to the hatred of America that has been an enduring fact of our national scene since the mid-1960s. It is a voice that also is easily distinguished from others with similar commitments. Chomsky is interested in a few truths that are always beyond dispute. His citations often loop back solipsistically to his own works. He argues with such imperious disregard for other explanations that he often seems to be talking to himself. The so-called war on terror is pure hypocrisy, virtually without exception. Can anybody understand that? No, they can't understand it. The Anti-Chomsky Reader does not seek to deprogram members of the Chomsky cult, but it does offer a response and an antidote to the millions of words Noam Chomsky has emitted over the last 35 years, and tries to explain to those who do not yet accept him as their Rinpoche what he has stood for during that time. Some of the ideas on his intellectual curriculum vitae that are discussed in the following pages, his defense of Pol Pot and the Khmer Rouge, for example, and his support of Holocaust revisionism, may surprise those who know Chomsky only generally as a bilious critic of U.S. foreign policy. Other commitments of his, for instance, his claim that the United States is a world power, is continuing the program of Nazi Germany, and his fierce hatred of Israel, will, unfortunately, be more familiar. But either way, as Chomskyism continues to grow at home and abroad, it is clearly time for a reckoning. Any work about Chomsky must begin with linguistics, the field he remade so thoroughly by his scholarly work of the late 1950s that he was often compared to Einstein and other paradigm shifters. Those who admire this achievement, but not his politics, are at pains to explain what they take to be a disjunction between his work in linguistics and his socio-political ideas. They see the former as...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.